Hi. Let's see if we can get through this without starving ourselves. Lunch is next, so I'll be sure to be short this week. First in line. Hello. This is a talk on being paranoid with your code and security. So, what are we going to learn about today? We're going to learn a little bit about me. Then we'll dive into the code side of things, where as a developer you can make the most impact to prevent security issues. A little bit of security on the server if you are going to host and want some info on that. Security plugins, just a handful, not anything crazy. And then we'll go to questions. So what about me? By day, I am a web developer for STAT, which is a medical and life sciences publication, part of the Boston Globe Media Partners. And I think about security all the time whenever I'm coding. I'm one of the co-organizers of this fine camp that we're at right now, the Boston WordPress Meetup, as well as New England Give Camp, where every year we get together for a weekend, lose sleep, and build sites for nonprofits that can't normally afford a developer. Next year, it's every spring. Next year it'll be around Cinco de Mayo. And when they did the last one, Cinco de Mayo, there was a piñata, there was a taco bar, and it was generally a good time. Me personally, I've been doing technology for about as long as I've been married. And the last 7 years, I've been doing web development. And just recently, I started taking Taekwondo. My family just adopted Cleo, a little puppy who's definitely a puppy, very energetic, deprives me of sleep regularly. But of like all Peppas of her generation, she does have an Instagram account. Get it? Petra, Cleopatra. She's not very prolific on Instagram, but she's getting her voice. She's getting her voice. All right, so let's dive into security and the code side. Like I said, this is the area where, as a developer, you have the most control, you have the most power to keep the bad people away from your plugins or your themes. So the first thing to start with is sanitizing and escaping. Sanitizing is what we would use, or functions they would use, on the input, so for form fields and the like. And then you would escape your output. When you take something from the database, you can never trust your data. This is like a cardinal rule, never trust the data, even if it's your own, because your data could look like a cute, fuzzy little bunny, but really it's a Knights of the Round Table eating machine, and you want to be careful of what you display. So WordPress, as we know, is built on PHP. And within PHP, there are some default, there are escaping and filters that come with PHP. The first three is array, string, and int, shows, make sure that you get what you need. Like if you're expecting an integer, that you get an integer. The last three are kind of go hand in hand. First one is filter var, and this one is used to confirm that the variable that you're getting does what you want it to do. So in this example, I'm expecting the stuff variable to be a Boolean. So I'm going to filter and make sure that that is a Boolean and that it's going to return true or false. If it returns 5, it's false. Filter input, that's on the input side. And basically that's used for it's used to filter the global variables, like global post, global get. You want to make sure that you're not using those just raw, just straight in. This will wrap around those globals, and In this example, it will make sure that that email variable that's in the get parameter will actually be an email address, and it'll strip out those fields that aren't those characters that aren't email-y. That last link shows the types of filters that you can use and standardization that you can use in filter bar and filter. So within WordPress itself, like I said, standardization is for the input. We mostly use that with form fields. And these are examples of some of them. So again, sanitize email basically does the same thing as the filter input, where it strips out anything that's not looking like an email address. Text field and title, there's text area. An escape URL raw is an escape, but it also can make sure that you are putting in a URL, but not modifying it so that it escapes out the ampersands and stuff like that. But it's still relatively sanitized. So escaping is really big in when you develop for WordPress. This is on the output side. So this is where you've got your variables, and no matter what's in your database, when you output it, you will escape out and strip out the stuff that could wreak havoc on your site. So escape HTML basically does that. Any variable that comes in that has HTML in it, it'll escape out. Like it'll turn the greater thans and less thans into the ASCII variant of that. Escape URL, it just makes sure that you have a URL. Escape adder, for the anchor tags, the title attributes, it'll make sure that those are just text. And JavaScript escapes out in JavaScript. WP cases post is used for, I kind of use it as a catch-all. So if I'm outputting content, but I want to allow some HTML tags to go through, cases post is what you use, is what WordPress uses in the content filter, and it allows just what you want to go through. WP cases post is a subset of WP cases where, if you take advantage of that, you can actually create a whitelist of tags that you want to go through. So say you don't want bold in anywhere in the content output, you can use WP cases, create a whitelist, and it'll respect that. So here's an example of doing some escaping. So I want to make sure that the audience variable only does text, and if there's any HTML that comes in, it makes it look all weird, and actually it'll translate it into like open and close tags, but it'll just output as text. It won't actually render those tags. Down below I have an A tag where in the href I'm going to escape the funky URL. And I'm going to use escape adder to escape the funky title. And then an A tag is not going to have, for the most part, I don't expect HTML to be within the containing A tag, so I'm going to escape that HTML. But down at the bottom, the next thing, I expect that to be content, so I want to just use cases post so I know what comes out and I don't get anything like SQL injections or cross-site scripting with JavaScript. Escape late. This is also a very important piece because what you want to do is you don't want to put in your escaping parameters during when you're initializing your variable or populating a variable. You want to do it on the output. You want to do it when you're actually putting it up on the screen to avoid something getting in the way, something coming in between your escaping and. By the way, it took me forever to find a GIF of someone trying to escape under a door. That took me forever. And I haven't seen the Scorch trials, but that worked pretty well. All right, so now let's jump to preventing SQL injections. Cardinal rule, creating a SQL statement should be like the last resort. Use the built-in WordPress functions because that's what they're there for. And they have the escaping built in. So WP Query, which is the class that makes WordPress WordPress, when you build a WP Query, you use that methodology, which also not only does your escaping, but also handles all your joins, all your filters, all that stuff comes with WP Query. Update post, delete post are a couple more examples. There's insert post, and then update option takes care of your options. You should never, there's always exceptions to the rules, but you should never have to create a SQL update or insert or delete statement. WordPress should be able to handle that for you. I think the edge case would be if you have a plugin that you need, that you're interacting with, that create their own tables, like Gravity Forms. That might be the place where you have to create that, but Gravity Forms itself, I know, is pretty good with their own filters and stuff, so you could probably take advantage of what they have and use their scheme. Just as an aside, WP List Pluck is like the unsung hero of WordPress. It allows you to take an array of objects and pluck out one field from that object. So say you're using WP Query and you have a list of posts, you get back an array of objects of posts. Instead of using a for each loop to loop through and just pull out that one piece that you need, WP List Pluck will look for, example, the ID and give you back an array of those IDs. So you don't have to do a whole ton of code, that'll do it all for you. So that in mind, like I said, you want to be very, very cautious when you create a SQL script. 9 times out of 10, it's going to be a select statement. But you, with much trepidation, you create a select statement. For one thing, WordPress is very complicated with their joins of tables and whatnot. And it's like, you know, there's, what, four, three, how many nowadays, turntables that all interact with each other. It becomes a little bit exercise in frustration when you have to start doing a select statement. But if you must, please take advantage of the WPDB global. This is a global variable that comes with a whole host of its own escaping and its own massaging of data. So this example, which I'm trying to, what I needed to do for this was provide in the comments page a column for term IDs, for terms, so that our editors could focus on the specific category that they want to moderate comments. So I'm calling the WPDB global, using one of its functions called getColumn, which, as advertised, grabs one column from the table. And then there's also getRow. And then use WPDBPrepare, which allows me to put in this little %s for string, and there's also %d, that's the only two that it really handles for integers. And %s will make sure that it becomes a string. Even though it looks like I'm pulling the comment ID, in WordPress the ID is a string variable, so we want to make sure that it goes in as a string. So this does its own little bit of escaping and does its own little insurance that a SQL injection won't drop all your tables. Next, nonces. Nonces are numbers used once is what it stands for. And these are very unique, single, time-stamped numbers that tie into the logged-in user's ID. So the way that nonces are used in core is when you are filling out a post, there's this hidden input field called a nonce. And that nonce is, like I said, timestamped and unique, and will ensure that if someone else tries to edit that post at the same time, you win. You can use it when you add a meta box to a post screen, the options screen, any of that stuff, and make sure that you are ensuring that no one else is going to either spoof that that input or take over what someone else is working on. Now, like I said, it's mostly used on the admin side because it needs that user ID. It can be used on the front end, and I've seen posts for it. I haven't given any examples because it's kind of squirrely, and it kind of makes the nonce a little more fragile because your users aren't going to be logged in, your visitors to your site aren't going to be logged in to WordPress. So there's nothing for the nonce to grab onto to say, this is Joe Smith's visitor versus Mary Smith's visitor. You'd have to like create a false user, which inherently will make that nonce fragile. So here's a quick little example. I have this example. I was adding a additional field to the featured image so that our editors could do a caption. So I've got the label for it, and I'm using a text area and the escape HTML for the text area. And just below it is this WP nonce field that has a combination of the name and the name of the nonce. And I'm sorry, I forget what true and false is, but I put one is true and the other is false. What this will do is when someone enters it in, that nonce, like I said, carries forward with that field and hooks into the save field function based on the post ID and the field name. And then it does this check to make sure that the nonce that comes in, and I know that I'm using the post global. I'm not sure why, actually. But use the post global to grab the field name that I'm expecting, because when it comes in, it's going to loop through and the field names come in one at a time. It's going to find the field name with the nonce label and verify that nonce against what's expected. That all checks out, then you do a bunch of stuff. All right, so that's all on in code side that I've got. There's plenty more, but that's a good start. So let's go to the server side. This is not within your theme. This is your core install. This is the host that you choose, etc. So I'm going to start with hosts. So hosting choices vary in price and vary in experience and how they understand WordPress. And of course, the top of the pyramid is just managed hosting like WP Engine or Pressable or Pagely. Those guys tune their servers for WordPress. They have caching built in. They will handle all the security and the updates of WordPress core, make sure all that stuff is hardened. So all you have to worry about is what you bring to WordPress, what you put in as plugins, what you put in as a theme, what you code. With all those advantages, of course, they're a little bit more pricey than your standard shared hosting. But standard shared hosting is also an option. Bluehost and A2 are downstairs, as well as GoDaddy. They're all, they've all started being WordPress-minded, which means they will provide an install. They will provide an install, but you're responsible for updates to WordPress on top of that. But what you get with them is they handle the security of their server, so they make sure they have patch levels updated and all that stuff. And it's obviously much cheaper than a WordPress managed hosting. But the onus is more on you to make sure that WordPress itself and the plugins and the themes are up to date. And the last one is where you roll your own. This is where you go to DigitalOcean or Amazon Web Services, and you create a server and you build everything from the ground up. The advantage is you know what you have, you know what you have installed and what patches you need to worry about. The downside is you need to know what patches you need to worry about. You have to make sure that you keep not just the server up to date, not just WordPress up to date, the whole shebang. Everything needs to be on you. I did this for a little while, and then I switched over to A2 hosting because I didn't want to deal with the server. I wanted to just deal with my websites. If like Heartbleed, which happened a couple years ago, that was in regards to a hack that was in SSL for years, and that became a big thing, and everyone had to scramble to update their servers. You don't have to worry about that, or you could yell at your host to make sure they worry about that. So other suggestions for the server side of things. WordPress allows you to move the WP config file out of that main directory. You can move it up one level, and it'll by default check where that WP config file is one level up. So that'll take it out of the HTML directory and allow people not to muck around with it. In my research, I saw a way of actually like moving it far, far away, like multi-levels up. But I think it was like creating a WP config file to point to a WP config file, seemed a little odd to me, so I didn't want to show an example of that. Changing the permissions of your files, even if you're on shared hosting. Now, WordPress managed hosting will deal with those permissions to core. But for your shared hosting or rolling your own, you can, through FileZilla or command line, change the permissions. And what WordPress suggests is, and I suggest too, is the directories should be writable and readable and executable by the owner, and then group and everyone else is just read and execute. That's directories. Files are read-only for everyone except for the owner, so that way you can be a little more certain. The only exception to that is the uploads folder in the uploads and plugins and themes folder, because then you need to be able to write. Actually, you know what? I'm going to step back one. I literally stepped back. I'm going to step back one and say that you could be a little bit more cautious with the core files. If you want to do updates, you need to make sure that it's 755 and 644. Those are the magic numbers to know. The last thing is, and this is by far not the minimal, not the everything you can do to harden your site. But the last thing you can do is add to wp-config this define statement to disallow that editor link in the admin, so you can prevent people from within wp-admin editing theme files, plugins files, and all that stuff. Because if you're, if you're in version control and you are, you're maintaining your theme that way, or the plugins are updated, you don't want someone to tweak a file, and you don't want someone to kind of mess around with that. So disallowing that file edit capability is kind of key for security. All right, plugins. I went really fast. So you told you to get you out of here. So security plugins. WordFence and iTheme Security, those are your one-stop shop for protecting your site from malware and DDoS attacks and, but hack people coming in and trying to figure out what your admin ID and password is. It'll block those IP addresses for a certain amount of time. It will give you reports of edited files so you can keep track of what files have been changed on your server. They both have premium features that will, I think iTheme Security also does, like two-factor authentication, all that type of stuff if you want to pay for it. The free versions are pretty good as in and of themselves. Jetpack is another, is an automatic product. That I suggest using and take advantage of the security features. They all also have a subscription model, but take advantage of those security features. But only if you are using something else in Jetpack, because Jetpack in and of itself is pretty big. You can turn on and off selective things, but using it just for security, I think, might be overkill. But if you're taking advantage of short URLs or galleries or any of that stuff that comes with Jetpack, then add that on there. And Login Lockdown is, I use that as a step, as an extra step with WordFence, to not only just monitor the logins, but if someone forgets their password X amount of times, it will lock out that ID for a period of time. And eventually, I think completely lock them out. It's pretty big on, there's a lot of stuff you can do with that. And the last one is two-factor authentication. And this one is specifically one on the plugin repo called Two-Factor, and it's done by it's created by an automatician, and a lot of other people in the WordPress field of note have contributed to it. It's gotten the ratings and all that stuff. I haven't personally used it, but I'm now very intrigued. There's also the Google Authenticator one and all that, but this one got a few more ratings. So resources. So in my research, I took a look at Mark Jaquith's WordCamp Phoenix talk in 2011. And even though it's 6 years old, it's still quite valuable. For those who don't know, Mark Jaquith is one of the developers of WordPress Core. And he also does auditing of people's themes and whatnot. And this talk is what he sees when he does those audits and what to prevent. It's a good talk. It's about a half hour long. It's not too bad. Hardening WordPress, plugin security, and theme security. Those three are pages on the codex that give you some additional information as to what to pay attention to and what to do for security. Plugin and theme security will duplicate each other, but when I looked at the text, it was like they went about it in different ways. So even if you're building a theme, look at plugin security. It might speak to you better than theme security and vice versa. And last but not least, because this is a talk on a tinfoil hat, I found an instructable on how to create a tinfoil hat. So get your hands on some tinfoil, right ahead. Show that it's working, and then, you know, pat it down so you don't look like a complete dork, and then, you know, put a hat on top of the hat to not look like a weirdo. And that said is about it. So I think we have the entire time for questions. Yes. Yes, if you wouldn't mind.
I've added top-level security. So you're talking about the login to WordPress. I added an HTTP access file that protects a WP login,
right,
password file, and that works great. So the server is filtering out a lot of garbage,
right,
and then they get to WordPress. So, but my problem is one of my clients has a password-protected page in WordPress.
Right.
And those customers are now getting the top-level login restriction, and I don't want them to. Any way around that? Or is that not a good question for this
forum? No, it's perfect. How are you password protecting? Just, is that a private page? Or is it?
Oh, it's just WordPress, a password put in for a private page.
Okay. I would, offhand, it sounds like the code in your HTTP access, that regex, is a little too broad. And you might need to refine that down. I wouldn't know without really looking at the HTTP access file.
Well, it just protects a WP login,
right,
PHP.
Right. I'd have to look into it for you. I'm not entirely certain how the password-protected part of WordPress for a page itself, what it goes through. It might actually pass through the WP login page as well.
Well, it must be passing through it, because that's why they get the restriction.
Right.
That's
right.
My problem.
Security that you put in place, but if you create a page that's a customer login, you get around that. But then you have to use something like two-part authentication to put in a new security. It's the HTTP access that's blocking it out.
The customer login is not like a regular WordPress login,
right?
You know, like an admin gets in. It's just a private page login, so it didn't even occur to me that they'd get that restriction.
Right. Unfortunately, I've not really played a lot with the private page stuff, but I am more than happy if you want to meet me down at the Happiness Bar
okay,
after
thanks.
Lunch, we can take a look. Anything else? I wasn't that good.
My question is in regard to the nuts that you were talking about before.
Yes.
I understand you were saying to include a nuts when you're submitting information to your back end.
Right.
But is there anywhere that you have to verify the nuts? Do you have to write some kind of callback function or?
No. In this example, that save field function down below, this guy right here.
Mm-hmm.
There is a line in there called WP verify nuts.
Oh, okay.
And that that will do everything you need to, that will allow WordPress to confirm that the nonce is what you expect it to be.
But you don't have to put that in every, for instance, the constructor, if you're using object-oriented PHP or something, you don't have to put some kind of verifier in the constructor, you can just include it in this.
No, you would put that in, yeah, exactly. That would be in the method that you're using for, save field hook is, save post. If the save post hook will look for that and confirm the nonce on, in that regard.
Sure, thanks.
Okay.